Today, on a special edition of Total OS Today Podcasts, we have the PCA team. We have Spatry's Cup of Linen, Twinkle, Ping Pong Soup, Infinitely Galactic, and our host, Toaster Today.
Jeez, the kid buys a new BlackBerry Pi microphone and thinks he's Jay Leno or something. Hi, G, what's up? It's good to hear your voice. How are you?
I'm good, thank you. I had no idea who that was. But anyway, yes, I'm here.
Welcome aboard. Well, we have Spatry from Spatry's Cup of Linux. We have, of course, Infinitely Galactic, IG with a fantastic TV announcer voice. We have Pincast, and we also have Twill this week in Linux. How are you, sir?
I am excellent. Thank you for asking.
It's good to have you back. So, this is something new. We are debuting the brand new PCA team, or we were kind of joking in pre-chat, the PC indecisive team for all of you dual booters who can't decide what to boot in. But officially, it is the PCA team. And for tonight's topic, we will discuss Linux versus Windows. Which is better? Which is worse? The eternal battle between the two operating systems. Haha. So let me start off with the discussion, if I may. A few months ago, I was looking at one of the videos on YouTube, and one of the popular female show hosts did a discussion on, you know, Windows versus Linux. And she talked about four major talk points that apparently, and I'm paraphrasing, of course, but she said, well, what she was trying to say basically is that Linux is better and Windows sucks. But these were the top talking points. Number one, it's expensive. Number two, resource hog, and we're talking about Windows, of course. Number three, it's unstable. And number four, validation checks. Now, let me try to strike these down real quick, and then I'll let my fine friends chime in. Number one, Windows is expensive. Well, I bought a desktop last year, a name brand, a Lenovo desktop dual core, and I think I paid like $369 pre-installed with Windows 7. It runs fine. That doesn't seem too expensive to me. The second point, Windows 7 is a resource hog. Well, let me see. What kind of system requirements does KDE take? Pardis, Ultimate Edition, Unity with 3D. Don't they kind of recommend a gigabyte of RAM, kind of like Windows 7? The third point, well, Windows 7 is unstable. Apparently, she has never messed with Kden Live or ATI drivers. And the last thing, validation checks. Now, I personally don't have problems with validation checks as long as it doesn't give me a blue screen of death, which I have yet to see a blue screen of death in Windows 7. So I was looking at these talking points, and then in my mind, I'm jokingly saying, oh, sorry, my bad. Expensive, resource hog, unstable validation checks. She was talking about herself. Hey! Now, on that note, my friends can chime in. Spatry.
Well, I will say this. One of my biggest pet peeves is the validation checks, because obviously that's a resource that's running in the background, and it's a measure to basically treat paying customers like thieves. Now, also, I have encountered blue screens of death. I'm dual booting. I'm running Windows 7 right now. But the thing is, in my Windows 7 install, I have that completely stripped down. I mean, I have denied it internet access, so I don't have to worry about bugs coming in. And pretty much I have all the redundant services turned off, mostly because I'm playing a few games that I just can't get working under Wine. If it were not for, if I could get Wine running everything that I have in Windows, I would actually not even be dual booting at all. So Windows is a necessary evil for those few applications, but over time I have been looking for alternatives, so that I can, eventually divorce myself from Windows. But the thing is, I did pay a lot of money for that software, and I still want to get that good bang for my buck and get several years of use out of those programs that I purchased. So, unfortunately, Windows 7 is still a necessary evil, but hopefully not for long on my end.
IG, what say you?
Yeah, I mean, for me, Windows, there are some professional level applications which you just can't get running under Wine, under Linux. So you are kind of stuck with Windows in that regard. And as far as system resources go, it all depends on how much system resources you have to kick around. Because one thing that I have noticed is that, if I was to look at my system monitor are on Ubuntu right now, I'd be using probably about 700 meg of RAM. If I was doing the exact same tasks in Windows, I mean, I do have 8 gig of RAM, so I've got plenty to kick around. But if I did the exact same thing in Windows, I'd probably be using 1.4, 1.5, maybe upwards to about 2 gigs of RAM just to do the same thing. However, if you were to drop that down to 2 gig of RAM or even a gig of RAM, then I think you'd be able to take a bit more of an accurate look about system resources. So I think, at least in my experience, if Windows has the resources there, it's going to use them up. But Linux is going to perform about the same whether you have, it's going to use the same memory footprint and resources if you have a beast of a machine or just, a very light on. So, I mean, yeah, the system resources is a bit subjective depending on what system you're running. As far as validation checks are concerned, yes, unfortunately, Microsoft kind of created themselves a bit of a problem. You notice how Apple's OS X doesn't bother doing that simply because the whole system is so locked down anyway. So their software is all funneled through a software center now. And as far as the operating system itself, I don't think they even have any sort of validation checks for the operating system itself. So I think Microsoft kind of created themselves into a bit of, like, they created themselves a problem when they became so huge and corporate, and they tried to, squeeze every drop of money that they could out of their system. And, for better or for worse, because their system is, the industry standard, or at least it was. And there's not a whole lot you can do about the whole validation check side of things without looking shady. And once you look shady to Microsoft, then you are shady. So, it's really just one thing that you have to do, just to bow to what the corporate powers that be decide.
Fair enough. Pingcast, what can you say about this?
Well, I can't say right now. I'm on OpenBox. I'm at the moment with everything running. I'm at 397 megabytes of RAM and no swap used. So it depends on the environment you're running. KDE is about as heavy as it gets because it's just packed with features, and it depends on what you run. If you have strong hardware, you can run a heavy environment. If you have weak hardware, you're going to have to go lighter weight. And you have that option of length. You can have this in that environment. $300 for a system, that's a lot to drop. I mean, especially, I think that comes, that's part of the cost of the machine when you buy it. And so you're kind of just adding $300 to the price. That's a lot to add. And then you don't get the full features yet. You have to upgrade, to Ultimate, to unlock stuff. I think, trying to remember what it was, I think there was like a business edition of Windows 7 and Ultimate Edition, and someone told me the only difference was a language pack or something, but the price difference was huge. I'm trying to remember. But yeah, all these different versions with features locked down is just ridiculous. They're just price gouging you and emptying your wallet, and that's not really great. I mean, $300 and all you get the system. How much can you get from Red Hat for $300? You can get quite a lot. I mean, a subscription is only like, $100. You can get academic and stuff.
Well, I mean, I did look online just shopping for, computer systems pre-installed with Ubuntu, and I really, at least at the one website I went to, I did not really see that much of a difference in terms of price. Now, Twill,
see,
you and I...
That's what I've seen. Like systems that run Ubuntu by default, they seem about on par with what you pay for a Windows machine. And I think, I'm not sure, and Twill, you might have some more knowledge in this area, but I think with the amount of money that the hardware companies actually spend to get Windows pre-installed is not that much, because it's like OEM, volume licensing, as it were. It's just the hardware manufacturer gets power to dish out Windows as much as it likes, because it's a corporate company. They're paying Microsoft a certain subscription fee to hand out these licenses, these OEM licenses. And so it doesn't affect you too much as an end user. If you are buying, of course, an upgrade or a retail copy of Windows, then obviously Windows is going to get a full, unequivocal cut of that $300. But otherwise, I don't actually think that you're paying too much for Windows if you buy a brand new machine, because usually the hardware company is paying Windows for pre-installing their system. I'm not sure, but Twill, you might have some input on that.
Yeah, actually, the part of that I've been experienced with is specifically with companies like Dell, with HP, others like that. You're paying for the hardware with an OS on it. The best option that they seem to have in terms of making good revenue is offering one that has Windows on it, because of the amount of bundled stuff they can put along with it. They can bundle antivirus software that they get paid to put on there. They can bundle Office suites. They get paid to put a starter edition of it on there, because every little piece of software they put on there that niggles away at you and makes you kind of angry that it's there, that's something that someone potentially could pay for. So another software company will give them a small fee to put it on there.
Okay,
so when you get your new computer that has Trend Micro or McAfee or Microsoft Office pre-installed on it, but a very limited edition, whatever company has sold you that computer gets a little fee. So you're actually getting that Microsoft tax on top of it.
Ah, Okay. Yes, Spatry, you have something to say?
Yes. You know, if you think about all the different versions of Windows that are out there, okay, just picture, if you will, this is like a Swiss Army knife, and you get the number of blades, you know, that you paid for. Whereas when you have a Linux operating system, you get all of the tools, and the only limit is your imagination.
You get all of the tools, but not necessarily all of the tools are necessarily good or stable versus horse stable. You know, a lot of something or everything of something is not necessarily all good. Now, when I see comments that Windows is unstable versus Linux, well, in my experience, it seems to be the opposite. Now, I'm not including viruses, spyware, and you didn't install a virus shield and don't maintain it. The one horse stable thing about Windows is you need a virus shield. I mean, that's all. I mean, you really can't really escape from that, and it has to be maintained. You don't need that in Linux, at least not yet. This may change in the future, and that's why I like Linux. But, I mean, in terms of what I paid for my desktop and what it does, you know, I mean, look, a new version of Windows comes out, what, every 3 to 5 years. So as far as upgrading, that's not an issue to me, because if a new version comes out in 3 to 5 years, I probably should buy a new computer and sell the one I have. In terms of being a resource hog, yeah, I would probably say Windows 7 uses more. I just don't know if I would necessarily call it a hog, but as IG says, it will depend what you are running. Validation checks, again, don't really bother me that much. I realize that can be a nuisance, but, you know, I don't know. Look, I don't work for, you know, Microsoft, and no one's paid me, but I've had lately, really since Windows 7 beta, I've had good luck with Windows 7, and I guess I am the only person here that has not seen a Windows 7 blue screen event. I just haven't seen it. I have yet to have a virus affect my system. My virus shield usually catches it, quarantines it, and I choose whether, you know, to delete it or keep. I usually just erase it. But look, maybe it's because I know what I'm doing, and I take the extra steps to keep my system stable. I don't know.
I think that is actually a large part of it. Between that and between the resource utilization, large part of it comes down to the end user. Because if you hand an end user a Windows machine and a Linux machine, depending on their level of technical expertise, you will get someone that either uses 2 to 4 gigs of RAM merely on making the operating system look pretty, or you'll get somebody that ultra optimizes everything and is only using 12 megs of RAM to run OpenBox, and that's all you get, or somebody who's running purely the terminal. It really depends on who it is that's running it as to how bloated it's really going to be. Because you can take Windows 7 and turn off all the pretty effects. You can turn off all of the arrow stuff and the pretty colorful interface and make it look like classic Windows that runs on really low amounts of RAM.
Right.
We've actually got a bunch of machines at work that are running it on 1 gig of RAM and doing okay. I'm not going to say that they're really, really amazing machines in that aspect, but they are surviving. They're useful for production. That said, in the same instance, you can take a Linux machine and put KDE on it and put some really heavy apps on top of it and make it run in 2 or 4 gigs of RAM and eat every bit of that. But at the same time, like they were saying earlier, you do have that option. If you are technically knowledgeable, if you are willing to spend the time doing it, you can trim it down. You can put down whatever you want to put on it. It's all in, how technical your end user is.
And I think one other point is that, as you were saying, Twill, if you were to give a new user a new computer that runs Linux, and then give another new user a new computer that runs Windows, come back in 6 months' time and see if they're still happy with how fast their computer is doing, I can guarantee you that the Linux machine will still be doing, you know, maybe a little bit slower, but mostly on par with what it was when you first bought it, whereas the new user who's using Windows will become frustrated with how slow their machine's getting because it's just a lack of knowledge about how to maintain Windows, how to keep it running happily and smoothly and keep it, you know, maintained.
Well, and in a lot of cases, those seemingly small antivirus or anti-spyware or internet security suites you put on top of them, they seem small and insignificant at the beginning, and they can become resource hogs themselves.
Yes,
absolutely.
So over time, I will say, over time, Windows 7 is a little bit better than XP was in terms of after so many months you have to reinstall, because that's really not the case with 7 if you do take care of it.
Yes.
But I have actually, my opinion on it has changed a little bit recently, having users that use it every single day, and after just a couple of weeks, had them coming back saying, you know, this is running so much slower, this is doing this and that and the other, and it's just because of things Windows is doing in the background, like trying to sync documents or trying to update itself, trying to all sorts of things that it's not really letting you know that it's doing. And
Yeah, but that can be a hassle in of itself, too, because, I mean, you've got to defragment your hard drives. You have to keep your registry cleaned, especially if you like testing different programs and that sort of thing. You uninstall something, there are traces that are still left in the registry and that sort of thing. And these are things that you don't have in Linux. Now, on the other hand, though, I am running Windows 7. I have a classic shell running on it. And a pro tip for all of you out there who are running high-end games in Windows 7 or Vista or that sort of thing, there's this really cool program. It's freeware, and it's called Game Booster. It allows you to defragment your game drives. It allows you to clean your memory and that sort of thing, so you can get that extra bit of boost and that sort of thing. But these kind of maintenance procedures you don't have to do in Linux. And unfortunately, yes, you have to do that in Windows. And a lot of people, your lay people that are out there, don't even know about this. They don't know how to defragment their hard drives. They don't know how to clean their registries and that sort of thing. But there are a number of tools out there that are easily obtainable.
But if everybody knew how to defragment their hard drive and maintain their computer, then half of the computer technicians would be out of a job overnight. Because literally, people charge $80-$90 to do those maintenance tasks.
Right.
Jeez, I need to get in on this.
Sorry, go ahead.
I think Best Buy probably would have gone out of business a while back if that were the case.
I need to get in on this action.
Yeah. go Pingy Co.
Okay, for defragmentation, I think Windows 7 automatically does it from time to time, but if something's running, it's not gonna the file's being touched, it's not gonna be defragmented.
I think it's the professional editions, the business editions that automatically do it.
Yeah, I don't think the home edition does that.
I don't remember. I think I have premium or Ultimate in my desktop. Honestly, I can't remember, but yeah.
Windows really needs to do itself a favor and just consolidate down to one system, because it's ridiculous having all the different volumes and editions.
IG, I would have to agree, because I think with Windows 8, they're going to release, I think, 6-7 versions. That's just a bit much.
Oh,
I
mean,
I can understand. And even me here, I am trying to defend. I can't defend that. I mean, you know, 4. I think that's pushing it.
And that brings us back to the Swiss Army knife. And while you had stated earlier that there are a lot of these tools that are not so good, you're forgetting that in Linux, we've got 3 or 4 tools that do the same task. So if one tool doesn't do the job for you, you can easily uninstall it and put it in a different one that you like better. So, you know, at least with Linux, you have all those options available to you, and most of them are free of charge.
Pingcast, have you had a blue screen of death using Windows 7?
Once.
Just once?
Just once. Yeah, I remember right around, I think it was, might have been around Steve Jobs' death or something. I was trying to see something on Apple's website, and it required me to install QuickTime, and when I tried to run it, I got a blue screen.
So this would have been, what, last year? Okay.
Yeah.
Horse stable.
Yes, I agree. All BS. Shut up, Spatry. Here we go. Don't start. I'm still recovering from
last
night.
Don't get Spatry started. Yeah, last night was a hoot. For those of you who didn't catch that show, you got to hear that one.
Yes, catch the Sunday Night News and Nonsense Report. Me and Spatry did. By the way, it's on Sunday nights. Any of you guys are welcome to join, but I warn you, Spatry will be. Yeah, he will show no mercy, guys. But
show his real teeth.
Real. You got it.
What were we talking about?
Actually, sorry to jump back a little bit. It looks like the Windows 8 editions might have been revamped in the last week or so. It was like 6 or 8 editions before, but they say they're down to 3 editions now.
Thank you.
Okay.
I'll buy into that. There you go. Maybe Microsoft is actually listening to its customers. Hey, imagine that.
It says Windows 8, Windows 8 Pro, and Windows 8 RT, which was previously Windows on ARM. So you've got essentially a tablet edition or a phone edition kind of thing, home and pro.
Which actually brings us to a very important point, and that is that, you know, right now we're comparing Linux to Windows 7, but I think when Windows 8 comes around, especially from the traditional user's point of view, there's going to be some very interesting comparisons as to what everyday users are going to want to use. I think the next generation of people coming up who have, you know, grown up on smartphones and that kind of thing, they're not going to have an issue with it. But for your, you know, mom and pop kind of thing, it's going to be, I think, a very interesting transition for anybody who wants to buy a new computer. I think there's going to be comparisons galore when it comes to the desktop, you know, desktop operating system. And I've said it before, but I really think you know, Ubuntu 12.04 is shaping up to be a very, you know, viable desktop alternative. Yes, it's, you know, it's different and it's modern, but it's a good kind of modern. It's efficient and it suits what the form factor is, as opposed to big clumsy tiles that kind of look a bit, I don't know, they look a bit 80s in nature, really, with, you know, just big flat colorful, you know. And I mean, sure, it's just the Metro interface, but still, paradigm changes are so difficult for the consumer market to latch onto. So I mean, I think it's going to be interesting this year and next year when we all start comparing, you know, the various Linux distributions to Windows 8, because that's going to be like it or lump it, the next industry standard.
Well, and that's actually the big thing, the word you mentioned there, the paradigm shift. The entire desktop interface has changed in the last year, and Microsoft is making their way in that direction as well, moving away from the traditional, you have a bar at the bottom, you've got your start menu, and you've got some icons on the desktop, to more of a tablet interface, you know, a full screen. Here are, you know, apps that you can select. Here are live widgets that you can alter, kind of like Android has, like Windows 8 will have, Windows Phone. Actually, I think iOS and OS 10 Lion have some similar things with their launch pad. I don't know. Things are moving more in the direction of a tablet type interface. And I think it's the end user that's eventually going to have to take their time and sort of relearn how to use the desktop.
Yeah. I wanted to ask Pinkhas, how often do you use Windows 7? 50-50, or is this something completely different?
At the moment, because I've had some changes with my living arrangement because stuff has come up. So at the moment, my desktop's not in a place where it can get a decent internet connection, so I haven't been able to get on it at all. I've just been on my laptop. But when I was on it, I would get on it to game, or on Windows 7 to game, or whatever, if it required Windows. If it didn't require Windows, I would be on Linux doing it.
Okay, it appears that, from what I understand, you know, perhaps Windows 7 still has an edge for gaming. Would that be a fair statement?
I'd say so.
Oh, absolutely, yeah.
Okay. Unfortunately, yes.
Oh, okay. For me, I mentioned this before, I don't play games on any PC. For me, it's my trusted Xbox 360. I'm a big Halo fan. And by the way, guys, I can't wait for Halo 4 to come out. I think it's going to be a hoot. Now, a couple things I want to end this topic, and maybe we can go into talk a little bit about, you know, Windows 8 if you want to. I think perhaps when a pre-installed Linux computer system is shipped out, perhaps there should be a big disclaimer, red label, that says install software at your own risk. Not the pre-installed software, but the other software, you know, from the Synaptic Package Manager and the Software Center, because it's not all good. A lot of it's good, but then a lot of it is not good. So maybe a disclaimer, okay? Install software at your own risk. We only guarantee the pre-installed tested software. On the Windows side, there should be probably even bigger, you know, red sheets saying you must install a good antivirus, you must maintain it, and avoid all porn sites. maybe, you know what, to be diplomatic, they either are both good, or maybe they can both suck. So there you go.
If you put the porn disclaimer, you might have a lot of people looking for that Ubuntu ISO. Okay.
Well, and actually, to sort of hit both of those,
that one.
The Software Center, they actually have people on staff at Canonical, or people on staff at least in the Ubuntu community, that are masters of the universe, that are supposed to be keeping track of those pieces of software, making sure that bug reports get taken care of, making sure that the software is stable, is usable. The problem a lot of people do face is whether the hardware they're using is 100% compatible, and that's still always going to be up in the air. On the Windows side of things, having done several Windows 7 installs in the last couple of months, it really pops up and annoys you if you don't immediately put an antivirus software on it, if you don't put Windows updates turned on, if you don't turn your firewall on, it annoys the crap out of you. I will say the one thing that I really hate about it is that user access control, but that is quick and easy to disable, though that it shouldn't be. But like you were saying, they need to do that. They actually have been doing it since Windows 7 or Windows Vista, I think. I mean, annoy the user, but it's more an annoyance than a usable feature for most people.
Right.
Do not disable the user access control, because then pretty much you're just giving your system over to the viruses and malware and everything that'll creep in. The best bet is to do this. You create, you know, you have your administrator account, then create a standard user account and use that. And then when you need to install something or whatnot, log in to your administrator account and install everything. That way it's the best way to protect your system, really.
Whatever happened to Windows just applying a Linux strategy, just sudo everything, which I guess user account control is similar to that, but it's much more obnoxious.
I think sudo would cause more blue screens of death than anything.
What I've done is if I need to install something and right-click run as administrator didn't work, what I've sometimes done is open up a admin command prompt on the normal account and I'd run the file as administrator in the command prompt.
Very sound idea.
Did somebody hear a motorcycle?
I did.
Yeah, I got a motorcycle in the background here. Sorry for that, for not muting my mic there.
It sounded like you just scared away one of your Windows friends, Spatry, you know.
Actually, I'm installing Linux on one of my neighbor's computers right now as we're speaking.
So you still, you're installing Pingi, right?
Pingi on a netbook.
Ah.
Yeah, okay. I just upgraded the kernel and now I'm installing all the updates.
All right, let me, if I may, I have one final comment on this and then of course you guys can chime in. Twill mentioned about how the developers Ubuntu take great care in testing stuff. I wish I could agree with you, but last month, probably all of you know about my recent boxing match with ATI drivers, and it said tested. that, I'm sorry, I cannot trust it, at least not in the near future. So for now, temporarily, Spatry, shut up. But for now... And Spatry says, well, you didn't read the fine print at the bottom. Yeah, and the fine print says, bleep you, right. But that left a bad taste in my mouth. And I'm not going to blame anybody specifically. That being said, I think the quality gap from the core within the core system between Linux, well, some Linux, such as, you know, Zorin and Ubuntu 12.04 and Windows 7, I think the quality gap is getting narrow as far as the core system and what can be trusted. But man, I had to reinstall Ubuntu twice. Thank God Windows 7 to the rescue, and that just left a bad taste in my mouth. Now, I'm sure that's not the entire pieces of software out there, but that, you know, look, folks, if you're buying a new computer with pre-installed Ubuntu Linux, all I can tell you is from my experience, if it's already pre-installed, chances are it's been tested. At least I would hope so. Same thing with Windows
too.
Yeah, and this goes for Windows too, by the way. But you install software in Linux, you install software at your own risk because I don't really know if it's been tested. With Windows, you install software at your own risk because of possible, possible viruses and spyware. But here's the thing: I'd rather choose Windows. Here's why: you can install an antivirus shield for some protection. There's no such thing as an anti-bug shield. Once you have it, it's there. So you know.
But then just your responsibility. Then is just to track down whatever version that is and see if you can upgrade. It. But of course, if you're an average Joe, you're not really going to think of doing that, are you?
Right. I'm more for the consumer mom and pop. You know, for them, as long as they have a good virus shield, you know, they can scan the computer, delete it, reboot, and hopefully it's done. And I say hopefully, not always. With a bug, you know, you have to spend, you know, when I had the ATI driver issue, you know, I've told myself, if it takes me more than 59 minutes to find out what a problem is, I refuse to do it. And it's even less for Windows. I'll just reinstall the whole freaking system. You know, my time is valuable, you know, because, you know, family and the son and maybe Twill might appreciate this, you know, with his family and, you know, and kids. But that being said, in both operating systems, if it takes me more than 59 minutes to, say, clean out a virus, I'm done. I'm just reinstalling it. With Linux, if it's a bug, you know what? Look, perhaps I may, you know, PM Spatry or Twill and all my good friends here for a solution. I might do that. But my patience has gotten thinner with both operating systems. And that's as probably as diplomatic an answer I can give. Both operating systems can be superb and both can be horse table depending on the circumstances. So
I think one other tip that might be worth mentioning here as well with when it comes to installing applications on Ubuntu, specifically in Ubuntu derivatives, is that you were talking about software being tested by Canonical and things like that. The repositories there, when you go into software sources under the Ubuntu Software Center, they have the checkboxes there. So you've got Canonical supported free and open source software, which is the main repository. Then you have community maintained. So you can, if you're that paranoid about installing software that might not potentially work the way it's supposed to, you can uncheck the community maintained, and then you'll just be left with a much more limited, but it's still going to be endorsed and supported and tested by Canonical themselves to make sure that it works. And this usually covers most of the big applications.
That's fair, but I still stick with my solution. In both operating systems, install software at your own risk.
That makes sense.
Surf foreign at your own risk.
Well, that too, but I mean, wasn't there a report of a virus in Linux? Wasn't it just last month or month before that was somewhat serious? Did you guys
sure that wasn't that? Mac OS X?
I don't use Mac, don't you, IG? How do you like Mac?
Oh yeah, it's got its own points. They've definitely borrowed concepts from Linux and vice versa. So yeah, okay. It's very nice. It's a very comfortable place for the end user, because there's only one way to do things, and that's the Apple way. Once they've figured that out, then they're at home. Safely just doing their thing.
Right. Well, who knows? Maybe in a couple of years we will have the Mac 18 or not, but it's just a thought.
There's plenty of them already, I assure you.
Okay. Well, as far as this topic goes, any closing comments?
I have one. In terms of the drivers, and I know this is something that really had you upset, Total yes. OS today. You know, if your display is working well, I really don't recommend installing the ATI drivers. Regardless of which distribution I was running, I never really liked them. I thought the stock Xorg drivers worked just fine. They do very well for running 3D games and programs in Linux. So, I mean, I kind of wish ATI would release better drivers. Now, instead of using the update manager to install those drivers, I was actually downloading them from the AMD ATI website and installing them that way. I've had some okay results, but the thing is, sometimes I'd run into screen tearing and that sort of thing, and even clicking the setting to reduce tearing and stuff didn't always work, and you know, there was always one little niggle that just rubbed me the wrong way. So I avoid them, and even since I switched to Arch, the Arch wiki also recommends against using proprietary drivers, and I found that just using the stock drivers tend to be a lot better for me personally.
Yeah, that's been largely my experience. As well. Ever since about 2010, the open source drivers for ATI cards have been, more than capable, in my opinion.
In most cases, I definitely agree. I did find recently I had to install the proprietary ones for a 3D game. It was Amnesia, and it has some decent 3D requirements, and it just would not run at all on the open source driver. It didn't even tell me why. But as soon as I put the ATI proprietary one on, it worked just fine, and haven't had any problems since. I had one little issue in that I'm using dual monitors, and it didn't recognize displays immediately. I think that's actually a bug that's fixed in 12.04, though.
I did notice when I looked online, just to pretend shop for Ubuntu-based, pre-installed computer systems. Mm-hmm. If I recall, not a single one had ATI cards. They were like NVIDIA or something else. So maybe
either Intel or NVIDIA, usually every time.
Okay. Thank you. So I wasn't just imagining things. And just my luck, I had to buy a machine with the ATI. But then I'm like, well, wait a minute. That's not my machine's fault, But yes, I would agree. Don't just stick with the Zorg drivers and then go from there. But that seems to be working, in my system. And honestly, even if I did install the ATI and there was no bugs, how much better could it be? I mean, I really don't. Well, I mean, I don't know because I couldn't really test it. But how much better would it be? So I don't know.
At the end of the day, you've got to think of, what do the companies have to gain by spending their time and resources on developing proprietary drivers for Linux? We are such a small market share, and unless they have a vested interest because a company that pays them money depends on those drivers, they're not really going to do too much work on it.
Right. Okay. Pingcast, you have any closing comments on this topic?
I'm an ATI user. Both my machines have ATI cards. I have had bad experiences with a proprietary driver. For me, open source work just fine, and I started Linux using it right around 2010 when the drivers took off. So
okay.
I have no idea about the woes before then. I never had to put up with them. ATI has been working fine mostly for me. I've had maybe an issue or two here or there, but it's been fine for the most part.
I think just the very fact that you can install a Linux system on really any machine, and you can usually get native resolution, and usually you get 3D acceleration compared to installing Windows Windows 7 or Windows Vista or Windows XP on any kind of machine, you usually have to go out and grab the driver for your computer. So I think in that respect, you know, the hardware drivers that come pre-installed, but, you know, by the open source community, they get packaged up. I reckon they do an amazing job to have that out of the box, you know, functionality. In most cases, I'm not going to say blanket statement, compared to the amount of fussing around you have to do with Windows machines.
All right, let me end this, if I may, with a gripe about Microsoft, even though I've been trying to defend them. But when the last multimedia laptop I bought, it's outdated. It's a Pentium N with Ubuntu 12.04 dual booting with Windows. But I recall I bought it because I think at the time it was half off, you know, and it has the little remote control on the side and the dock with the speakers and the big 17-inch, and it was a good price. And I was able to upgrade for free by going to the website to get a free Vista upgrade disk. Now, it had Windows XP pre-installed, so I thought, well, you know, it's nice of them. I'll try, you know, Vista for free, because there was a sticker that said Vista capable or something like that. I'm like, okay, cool. Well, I installed Vista. After some research, I'm thinking, whoa. This only had 512 megabytes of RAM to run Vista. Oh, it ran it all right. It ran it like into the ground. It was so slow. And another thing, I remember seeing demos of all these cool, you know, graphics and error effects. How come mine doesn't do that? Oh, mine had the wrong graphics card. It had enough RAM, a dedicated video card, 128 megabytes. It had enough juice, but the wrong graphics card or the wrong chipset. So I felt misled. So Microsoft, I think you owe me a laptop. So on that note, does anybody else have anything else to say? Okay, why don't we do this? Let's leave the Windows 8 for when it gets released, or maybe closer to the end of that. Why don't we end this with one of the most frequently asked questions, how to install Linux as a dual boot. Spatry, about, was it last month or 2 weeks ago, we were trying to answer a question for someone who sent me an email on how to install Zorin on a 500 gigabyte hard drive. And we said, boy, that's a waste of time. Try a flash drive. You remember mm-hmm. that?
Yes.
Okay, well, all right, cool. He sent me an email and he says it's not working. He tried it from the flash drive and from a DVD. And I think if I recall the email, he says, well, I go into my BIOS, I choose to boot from either the DVD or the flash drive, and his computer just shuts down. And I'm thinking, boy, that doesn't sound like it's a software glitch. And, right, it's something with a hard drive. So how do you guys see it?
I'd have to say that there's got to be a hardware issue of some kind. Probably something that could be done, and I could be wrong on this. Maybe considering upgrading the BIOS.
Okay.
I think that could be done to see if that corrects the issue. Also, depending on the image that was loaded onto the DVD or the flash drive, when you download an image, I can't stress enough to run an MD5 sim. Now, in Windows, you're going to need to actually download an application that will let you check an MD5 sim. And anytime you download an ISO image for a Linux distribution, underneath it or somewhere next to it, you're going to see this string of numbers. It's going to say MD5. Some you're going to have this string of numbers. And then you use this Windows application. After you downloaded that ISO image, you run the MD5 sum, and those numbers should match. If they don't match, then you have a corrupt image. And this very well could be also be the same issue that this person is experiencing. They probably just have a shoddy internet connection and just got a bad download. But if the MD5 sums do match, then another troubleshooting technique would, and as a last resort, I would say try updating the BIOS. Most PC manufacturers have a simple tool that will allow you to upgrade your BIOS to the latest and greatest and that sort of thing, and do it in a non-destructive manner. Make sure that you follow the instructions that come with that device, because if you lose power, if you're not completely plugged in, that sort of thing, while you're actually flashing your BIOS, you can actually brick your system, and that's something you really don't want to do.
Yes, absolutely.
One other point that I probably should bring up here, because I had a very similar situation not that long ago with a friend's laptop, and he had a Sony Vaio, and or however you say that, and and one of the he actually had a setting in the BIOS which prevented booting from external devices. So I actually set up the boot priority to boot from the USB or from the CD-ROM. I think it was the USB, and we rebooted the system, and it would just keep rebooting, like into whatever was on the hard drive, completely ignoring the settings that we'd set up in the BIOS. It wasn't until after that we actually looked under the security tab of the BIOS and found that there was a setting there to prevent booting external devices, and that was enabled by default. So I'm not sure whether there might be an issue there.
Oh, it could be just some kind of a setting in that gentleman's, like in the BIOS. That's a possibility, sure.
Yeah, there are a lot of possibilities. Impossible to tell, at the moment what exactly is going to be allowed.
Yeah, from the email I was, he sent, it sounded like he was really trying to try and install Zorin as a dual boot, but he says, I wanted to try it first to make sure that it works, which I completely understand. And I'm not sure if on the Zorin website it gives clear enough instructions how to do it. I know on the Ubuntu website they did a terrific job to make it, shall I say, dummies proof, for some Windows users on how to try Ubuntu, and maybe Zorin maybe can copy some of the wording there. But I downloaded the latest Zorin, 5.2. I installed it both from the Unibun or disk. I didn't have any issues, but I did have to go into the BIOS. So again, it could be the MD5, a corrupt file. It could be you may need an updated BIOS, but be careful with that, or a simple setting in the BIOS that perhaps that gentleman is missing. And it's happened to me too. Maybe I might just miss something, but it should work. Zorin is a good operating system for new users. It is stable. So anyway, if this person is listening, try that. If it doesn't work, please let me know, and we will maybe suggest something else. Okay. Gentlemen, we have another, 10 minutes. Would you like to spend some time closing it out on what's happening in the future, like in our respective channels, and then we will close out the evening?
I'm going to have to run because my wife is going to be home with groceries here in about a minute.
Okay. Well, thank you for coming on. We do appreciate it. Thank you, sir. Yes, yeah. But go ahead.
But yeah. In terms of the future, I don't know if I had mentioned it before or not. I am actually going to be making some videos over on the youtube.com/XDA developers channel, talking just weekly recaps of what's going on over on the website. And, of course, my channel will be sort of doing a reboot in the next month, hopefully. I'm in the process of moving from one house to another, and it's just really chaotic. So I have is really pressed.
Moving is for stable. Totally agree.
Yes. But anyway, thank you guys so much for having me. I do appreciate the opportunity, and I just heard the garage door open. So have a great night, guys.
Good night.
Take care, my friend. Yep. Good night. Bye. Pinkcast, what can you update us on?
Okay, yeah, I've been busy, guys, and to all my subscribers or watchers right now, sorry, guys. I've just been busy with stuff, so I haven't been able to do videos, and I really am going to try to upload one. What was I going to say here? As I said, desktop was a machine I was doing all my work on, and at the moment that's not usable, so all I have is my laptop. Trying to get a distro on this that works, and it doesn't have the spec to, like, my desktop, so it needs to be a bit lightweight. So I'm finding a distro for this machine, and once I do, I'll do some videos on that, and I have promised Gentoo videos, so I'll be doing Gentoo videos as well, and the Slack spins will continue, so stay tuned to those. I like doing the Slack spin, and I'll just pass the mic to somebody.
IG.
Yeah, well, I'm actually looking to review the XBMC Media Center at some stage, because there was a release that came out at least a month ago from XBMC, and they are a fantastic multimedia center that you can use on your TV, on your laptop, whatever. So that'll be coming up, and obviously we have the Ubuntu 12.04 review, and I'm also going to try something different in that I'm actually going to do a written review of Ubuntu 12.04 over on my blog as well. So we're putting some effort into that, because I think people do really need to see the ins and outs of Ubuntu 12.04, as it is a long-term support release. And I think, if we can do our part to spread the word about it, then, the more the merrier.
Yeah, that's right. Ubuntu 12.04. Spatry, did you say Thursday is the official release date?
I believe so, yes.
Wonderful.
And I love it that we're all already running it.
Yep. Yeah, like I said, I installed it even on my own phony Vista laptop. At the time I installed, I did have to boost RAM from 512 to 2 gigabytes in it. But yeah, Ubuntu 12.04 has impressed this Windows 7 user immensely. Now, it is an old laptop with a rather outdated processor. system. So it's not as zippy as I would like it to be, but that's not Ubuntu's fault at all. But for me, since Alpha 2 and now, the core system has been stable, not necessarily all the software because of all the updates day in and day out, but I'm impressed. And I think Ubuntu 12.04 might be, time will tell, might be a viable replacement for your Windows system. Spatry, what do you have coming up in your channel?
Well, Sunday night news and nonsense.
I love it. IG, one of these nights you have to jump on so he can torture you instead of me. And Pinkcast, the more buffers I can get, the better for me.
Hey, well, the thing buffers? Total OS just has this knack for bringing it out of me. I mean, he picks out these news articles, and I mean, every one of these articles is just screaming funny, you know, some way, shape, fashion, or form, you know, I can find something funny to say about it, but you know, that's why it's news and nonsense. The Sinner Report.
Let's give Pinkcast a quick example, Spatry. Okay, here we go, Pink. Here's an example.
I didn't know what you meant by buffers.
Oh, a buffer. You be my buffer. You and I be like my shield. You defend me against Spatry when he goes.
Oh, okay.
Shield, a virus shield, a buffer. Yeah. Like a Halo shield, you know. But anyway.
I meant to what?
To what, Spatry? To his jokes, okay. Yeah. But let me give you an example. Fedora 17 is going to be called, are you ready? Beefy Miracle.
Boy, it sounds like something that you have after a bad meal.
Yeah, and the thing is, I made this comment, something to the effect of the hot dog, because they're going to use a hot dog for that.
I don't want to cut this out.
Let's not go there again.
Let's not go there. Put an adapter of a hot dog and the relish on one of the websites. And my thought was, okay, now the board of directors, I'm assuming, are in a locked room thinking about the next name. And my joke was, now, did this name come up before or after taking Viagra? Okay. And then, of course, Patrick did his thing. It was a little bit across the line. One of these days, maybe I'll let you guys list it in private, but that's as far as we're going to go. By the way, speaking of names, the next Ubuntu is coming out, and it's not what I thought. It's not what either of us thought. Spatry, do you know what it's called?
What?
IG, do you know what it's called?
Quintessential Q-tip?
No.
Yeah, unfortunately not, no.
Quagmire Whale.
I know the next. It's Precise Pangolin.
I'm sorry. The next one after Precise, 1210.
Oh, 1210, I have no idea.
Quantal Quetzal. I'm not lying. That's in my first. What the bleep is the quant? It sounds like a taco.
Quantum Quetzal.
Quantal. I imagine Wikipedia's hits for Quetzal would have just gone up over the
Quetzal,
last.
I believe,
like,
is a bird,
hours.
An exotic bird, and Quantal means I have no idea. But that's so we were both wrong, Spatry.
Hey, what's this? What version you? I can't pronounce it.
It's. I would have preferred Spatry's. It's quantum. No, what was it? Quintessential Q-tip.
Yeah, you see, you just stick it in your ear and squeeze the juice out of it.
That's a miracle.
So there you go. That's what we talked about last night on the Sinner Report, the Sunday night news and nonsense. And it differs from the usual Toscast, Linux A-Team, and now the PC A-Team in that it's meant to be, originally it was called a TTTBA, Toss Today Tech Brief. It was meant to be a formal, short, purely pragmatic, informational discussion on all things related to tech, like 15 minutes. Well, you know, once me and Spatry got into a chemical roll, I figure, screw the news, let's do the joke. So it's been changed to the Sunday Night News and Nonsense. Report. Sinner, for short, and you can guess who's the sinner and who's the victim.
Yeah, it's like little devil on one shoulder and little angel on the other shoulder. Yeah. It's perfect.
Yeah.
Let me guess, the victim's the person seeing Spatry's teeth.
Fortunately, you can't see.
So, but that's what's going on. That'll be, you know what, Spatry, maybe we should try to record these before if we can, so I can upload them Sunday so people can catch it Sunday night. I don't know, it's just a thought, but if we have time. But But okay. That's what's going on. Yeah, that's the center. And of course, IG and Pinkcast and Twill are definitely welcome. The only thing is, if we get a lot more people, then the show will, you know, extend and drag on. I don't want that. It's meant to be really 15, 20 minutes tops. Of course, by the time we all stop telling the jokes, it's like an hour later. But that's
that way we can speed it all up and make everybody sound like chipmunks. That might.
So instead of IG doing his slow motion today on Total. Bye.
Oh, no. That sounded like somebody had something in a vice.
That's really good. Down, boy, down. Are you still with us?
Yes, I'm still here.
Okay. If you want to chime in with a voice thing that you do, please be my guest. Can you do something else with your voice to make me happy?
Oh, man, alive. That sounds weird. I don't know. What else have we got to talk about, really?
We're running out of time. We only have 4 minutes left.
There you go. That was good. That was good. That sounds very TV announcer-like. Thank you. Actually, that sounds about right. Time is almost up. It's been about an hour. So, gentlemen, this was fun, as usual. I hope it was informative. Yeah.
I think we got a few useful tidbits of information. Yeah.
Yes. So, Pinkcast, closing comments real quick.
Since Spetsy brought up hot dog and fedora, have you gone to fedora.org and seen that dog in the hot dog bun?
Spetsy,
hot dog bun? Oh, no.
I think Fedora must have like a development team that their main job is to come up with just ways to make Fedora the most unrespected Linux distribution out there. I literally think that's what it is.
We definitely butchered it last night. Yeah, go ahead.
Says on the of the website, as always, we are not affiliated with Red Hat or the Fedora Project or people who like to wear hats while using Linux or any other entity. And it has the dog a picture above it.
I mean, I have no problem with unique names, but Beefy Miracle. I don't know what else to say on that. IG, do you want to close out the show?
Yeah, well, I can try to. I mean, this show could go on forever, really. But no, thank you, everybody, once again for tuning in. And we really appreciate you coming back and listening to these shows. The inaugural episode of the PCA team. Hopefully, we'll try and give you a bit of a balanced approach between the Windows, Linux, and possibly OS X worlds. And thank you, everybody, once again. And from all our respective channels, definitely check us out if you haven't already. And I'm sure most of you already have. Also, we will be trying to provide some MP3 links that you can download if you want to be listening to this when you're away from your internet connection, which would show a lot of dedication on your part and would show that we are mildly entertaining on our part. So thank you once again. And with that, I shall peace out and enjoy the rest of my day. And the rest of you can enjoy, I imagine, going to bed at some stage.
Thank you. This was fun. And I just had a thought for Spatry's new channel. Spatry's Cup of Imbalance.
In terms of what Infinitely Galactic was saying, sleep when I'm dead.
How about a nice big cup of Beefy Miracle?
Folks, thank you for listening. We will catch you, as always, in your Beefy Miracle future. Goodbye.
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 Goodbye.